Now I request our chief guest, Dr. Iram Raju, to speak. I'll introduce Dr. Iram Raju. Meanwhile, Dr. Iram Raju Behra is an economist, was a career banker of nearly 3 decades experience in SBI since 1966 till 1994. He is one of the 1,100 economists participating in the World Economic Survey of IFO WEF Germany every quarter since 2018. He was professor of economics at LBS NAA, State Bank Institute of Rural Development, ASCII, IBE, Indian Institute of Economics. He held key positions for these universities as external examiner for doctoral thesis as well. He addressed a number of international seminars like First World Economic Forum on HR in the third millennium at Bonn, SME Credit Risks at Manila, Kuala Lumpur, Financial Risks at Reuters Roundtable at Geneva. He's member of jury at Asia Pacific Bankers Congress, Manila. He's also heading state promoted industrial health clinic in innovation in revival and restructuring of MSMEs. He authored over 15 books and 2000 articles in financial dailies and reputed national published in reputed national and international journals. I welcome Dr. Iram Raju to address the gathering.
Good morning to all of you. Mr. Deshai, Mr. Sridhar, Mr. Purnanand, and all dignitaries, SME units, and friends. I have a small presentation. You will find from the very first slide that the institution I am representing, namely the Telangana Industrial Health Clinic, we have almost turned around 100 crore worth of assets, with more than 1,700 employees on sustainable livelihoods, and bailed out from SARFAESI about 130 lakhs worth of assets. You have today this seminar organized, but we are running late by at least 1 hour now. So I would not like to take much of your time, because many people have many notions about NPS. So I thought, what are the actual guidelines of RBI? What is NPA? Because banks classify willful defaulters according to the RBI circular, which is 23 pages. And I am very confident to say on this platform, has read this 23 pages, including the banker on the dais. If he says no, I will be very happy. And I will in fact bow to him. What are the various, you know, causes that lead to this situation, and what are the remedies, and why we have set up a separate institution? Where is the need for this? There are a number of institutions in this country, proliferation. Is there one more institution that is necessary? Why? Why it has become necessary? And what we are doing and how we are proceeding? See, RBI has classified assets. Those who are performing means those who are performing in full measure. That means they are complying with all the terms and conditions given by the lender, and they are also performing in terms of payment of their obligations in time as prescribed by the bank. And here they have classified past dues, interest, and outstanding due for 30 days, not 1 month. Because some months may be 31 days. But mind you, here it is 30 days. Am I right, Mr. Purnanand? Yes, because the system has given that instruction already. There is nothing that this banker can do or any banker can do. It automatically takes care of defining that as overdue if it processes 30 days. And past due for 4 quarters, past due for 3 quarters, past due for 2 quarters. Are treated as NPAs. 91 days, if one asset does not perform, it is NPA. It can also be NPA if an asset or if an entrepreneur does not submit his stock statements in time. If he does not submit his debtor statements and creditor statements as required by the bank, if he does not submit his annual statements of assets and liabilities or also and also half yearly statement of asset. Any of these criteria, if there is a default, he can also be treated as NPA. Many people do not know that he becomes NPA only if he does not pay for 90 days. No, it is not the case. Simple case is non-compliance with terms and conditions of the bank entail an entrepreneur to be classified as non-performing asset. Therefore, compliance culture is one thing that entrepreneurs must be getting used to. If they are not getting used to, somebody must help them to get used to. Because they are in unorganized sector, they were not accustomed to this. They were beleaguered by or they were bulldozed by a host of regulations. You will be surprised today in this country if an enterprise were to be set up. According to a statement in the Economic Times a few days ago, just before the budget, 2000 clearances are required. And if it is an MSME, maybe about today, earlier it was 167 clearances. Today it is only about much less, about say 65 clearances are still to be acquired. From 167 to 65 is a big jump we have been able to achieve during the past few years. Because of incessant pursuit by many of us, because of the simplification in the act that has come about, rules that have come about, because acts are framed by Government of India, rules are framed by the state government. And they have rules framed by central government, rules framed by state government for the same act. Therefore, you have a host of regulations engulfing the enterprise, which makes the enterprise non-compliant. When a compliance cost is more than the cost of avoidance, people prefer to avoid. Simple rule. And the government of India must recognize this, state governments must recognize this and reduce this compliance cost to the barest minimum. Then everybody will comply. How can we really engineer this? Can we take bull by the horns and tell the government, look, first of all you do this, then everything will fall in place. If you want unorganized to become organized, you should make compliance more easy, more comfortable. What you call as ease of doing business must happen. Therefore, if your NPS are to be reduced, it can't be reduced just by a fiat or just by, you know, ordaining a system to do that, but by making systemic changes and also legal facilitation. Then you have cash credit accounts. The NPS are defined differently. So where the outstandings in excess of sanctioned limits or drawing power continuously for 6 months, and outstandings less than drawing power but no credit for 6 months. Outstandings less than drawing power but credits are not sufficient to cover the interest debited during the same period. All these classify for getting declared as NPA. And then here also, out of order is 4 quarters, out of order for 3 quarters, out of order for 2 quarters, they can get defined. And at each of these layers, they can get addressed. If it is addressed, then it will come out of NPA. Once it is not addressed, it will not come out of NPA. And this simple thing is not being followed by the banker. Because banker today is so much overburdened by the system and returns and video conferences and everything else other than working on the bank and working with the enterprise. That is the tragic state in which branch manager is situated today. You are free to correct me if I am wrong. And the asset classification has got substandard assets and standard assets. See, the credit facility classified as NPA for not more than 2 years is substandard asset. And the general provisioning of 10% of substandard assets, and for standard assets also I think today there is a provisioning. Unlike before, earlier it used to be nil, as mentioned in the chart, but today there is a reduction even for standard asset. They have to make provision. And then for bills purchased and discounted orders, the NPA gets defined differently. And you have against all these types of accounts which you find in the chart, there are thresholds. And at one lower threshold, if you are able to address the issue, it can come out of the NPA. The tragedy is that you don't get that problem, so, you know, either surfacing or getting recognized, and that's why the whole thing comes into a standstill position. Next one, See, one is non-willful default. How do we address this NPA system? A non-willful default, generally people get into because non-compliance. Non-compliance cannot be called as willful default. Non-compliance can never be called as willful default. And willful default has been amply defined by Reserve Bank of India. As I told you, in 23 pages, they have taken a person to define as willful defaulter, 23 pages. And each page consists of 300 words. So they had to use 6,900 words to define a willful defaulter. And they are supposed, bank is supposed to give an opportunity for a willful defaulter to appear before a committee of the head office after the notice is received, why he should not be considered as willful defaulter. And if that opportunity is not given, then the courts will definitely treat this as a lapse on the part of the bank, and the so-called willful default that is stamped on him will get extinguished. And adequate generation of income, even if it occurs, if it is not passed through the bank account, then I can treat it as willful default. Simple definition, I am telling you. Enterprise functions very well. It meets its obligations elsewhere, but it doesn't route its turnover through the account and keeps the account in dormant condition, then it means a willful default. Then unit is not functioning, but the account is functioning. I have come across these cases, and not one or two, during the past 5 years, there are more. Unit doesn't exist, but outstandings exist, and also running of the account also is taking place in the bank's books. Banker is very comfortable, he is getting his interest, and he is showing statistics that he has lent money to MSMEs, but the MSMEs on ground do not exist. This fellow is a willful defaulter in the society's books, and there is a negligible or poor repayment of bank dues, or repayment status of others' liabilities if they are defaulted, then also it is willful default. So why it occurs? It is because, so in the case of units not existing, obviously there was no due diligence before the sanction of the loan and before the disbursement of the loan. Because you will be surprised, when we ask some bankers to show the units, they said, sir, I have reported just now, I am also searching for the unit. And somebody said, sir, the field officer is on leave. I don't know where the unit is. He generally tackles that. In other cases, field officer says he has reported just yesterday, and the branch manager has gone for training, sir. Therefore, I don't know where the unit is. Sir, these are not fiction. And there is a poor follow-up, unresolved grievances, inadequate repayment period. If the repayment status of others' liabilities are not honored, naturally, one should keep away from such units. See, there are, if the NPAs are bulging, there are certain reasons that you should ascribe to the bankers and to the borrowers. In the case of borrowers, it is poor management. There can be technological obsolescence. There can be miscalculation of the demand. There can be change in the lifestyle of the enterprise, conflict in partnerships, excess capacity building, overborrowing, or defective title deeds. Any of these reasons on the part of the enterprise can turn or can escalate the NPAs beyond the roof. And if you look at the attributes of the banks, they are no less poor appraisal or no appraisal, absence of monitoring and supervision, then non-recourse to legal remedies, then lack of exchange of information among the banks, because there are multiple banks which have lent to one single unit. You will be surprised, there will be two doors, one door is behind, one door in the front. The front door is having the label goods hypothecated to Bank of India, back door to Canara Bank, and both the bankers have not seen that unit. Inadequate working capital, then you have moratorium period, which is irrational. For example, if a technology takes for installation and coming into production, 9 months. If you give a moratorium of 6 months, what will happen? And after 9 months, he has to be given again a trial period of 3 months. So, wisdom demands that it should be given at least 1 year moratorium period. But bankers say, I can't give more than 6 months. So you have made the unit upfront NPA and depressed, you know, capital markets are another major reason. Then how do you remedy this? Make regular visits. I said recovery. See the recovery. Regular visits, have effective control. Catch the season. After all, food processing unit, it works very well during the season. Its repayment capacity is there only in off the season. Then there is no point in asking the fellow to pay my installments during the period when he does not have actual turnover. And I should fund him when he actually stocks. And I should fund him when the stocks are, I should recover when the stocks are depleted. And then organize the camps to educate them. Then verify the assets periodically. Encourage the borrower to come and explain to you. Don't scare him off because you are a king of money. Most of the bankers feel that they know more than the entrepreneur, which is absolutely wrong. Because they can't know 6,000 classes of entrepreneurs, 6,000 types of, you know, production. And they should think, they should be humble before the entrepreneur. Then I'm sure things will remedy very fast. Then rigorous action is required. After all, when you know at the end of disbursement of the first installment itself, he has bought a limousine car instead of, you know, putting the money in the unit, what prevented you from taking action on the third month? Nothing. But you have allowed it to remain. With the result, that fellow will merely take it for granted and he will definitely take advantage of his position with the bank. So you will have to apply your sledgehammer at the right time. And then yardstick of progress is extremely important. Have the yardsticks and keep the yardsticks. Where we come into picture, you know, why an institution has become necessary? It is because banks do not recognize a sick unit or incipient sick unit in that stage because they have to classify that unit as NPA. They try to buffer as much as possible. Very, very frankly, I am mentioning, they would like to see no NPA in their books, irrespective of what is happening exactly at the unit. What is happening in the book is more important to me than what is happening in the enterprise. That is what the situation of the bank is. Second one, the enterprise does not declare himself to be incipient sick or sick because he is afraid that his creditors won't pay him back the money. His debtors will not pay him back the money. Neither the enterprise declares that he is bad, nor the banks declare that the unit is bad, and he lives in that. Suddenly, when the sledgehammer is applied, like a surface notice, then he comes running to us. Running everywhere, including the branch manager, assistant general manager, regional manager, deputy general manager, general manager, general manager. He will go to all stages, exhaust all his means to stop the surface notice, and he exhausts the period of surface notice with that, with no reply. Right? Therefore, there must be some institution which listens to him. Number one. Number two. Counseling, mentoring, handholding, which are very essential for all the micro small enterprises, is just not available today within his reach. Very costly for him. Can we create a structure where within affordable means he can take recourse to this? Therefore, our and DNA is handholding, mentoring and counseling. We charge 2%. We don't give free, but a 2% will save him of all the harangues. First thing we do is, when he comes, he can today log in. So we have taken 2 years to establish this enterprise. This year is the actual year in which we are working very active. All the recovery I have shown to you has taken place during this year, most of it. And we have set up online facilitation. Whether he is from Adilabad or Khammam, he can log into the website, post a simple detail, responding to 10 questions. 10 questions will determine whether he can be accepted by us or not. Then we will ask him a few documents which are necessary for us. Last 1 year's bank statements, then his tax statements for the last 3 years, both income tax and also the turnover tax, whether it is today GST, earlier it was commercial tax. And then we ask him his last 3 years balance sheets in whatever shape they are, whether it is audited, unaudited, it does not matter, but he has to submit them. Given these four statements as accompaniments, we will hold a dialogue with him, our entrepreneur, along with a consultant, accredited consultant of our team, will hold a dialogue with the enterprise, do the due diligence afresh, go to the unit, decide what type of assistance is required, and then tell him. If on the basis of the application details and enclosures, if we feel that this person is willful defaulter, we upfront tell him, unless you rectify these things, you will not be entitled to step in our portfolio. For all this, after all, we don't ask upfront this, you know, 2000 rupees as the admission fees, is the registration fees of 2000 rupees. After those 10 questions are answered, and if we feel that we can entertain the application, then we ask him to pay 2000 rupees and we give a login and password to him, on the basis of which he can upload the applications, on the basis of which he can upload the entire data from wherever he is. And he can also seek the GMSDIC office to help him out, or he can come to our office directly when our executive, the frontline executive, will help him into uploading the documents. Then we will decide the fate of this enterprise within 5 days, what type of support we can give to him. Many a time, when he came with a request that he wants working capital. Sir, if you give me money, everything I will be able to resolve. But when we discuss, do the due diligence, go through five days, then he will say, no, I don't require money. And mind you, out of this number of enterprises that we have listed, 61 so far, 64, isn't it? 61, 61 enterprises, we have given financial support barely for about 15 enterprises by way of bridge finance and another 6 enterprises by way of, our financial products, either margin funding or stressed asset finance or critical amount funding. These are the 3 types of funding we give at different types of sickness. It's not as though that everybody requires only a margin money. Somebody may require critical amount funding. Somebody may require only stressed asset funding. So we decide on the which type of product is required and give him that money, give him that product. How we give him? We give him by participating with the concerned bank. In fact, Canara Bank, several branches have agreed to be, give pari passu charge, because we are bailing him out of NPA. The bank is also getting benefited in the process. SBI, pari passu charge. SFC, they have agreed to give pari passu charge. I think even Bank of Baroda has agreed to give pari passu charge. Indian Overseas Bank has agreed to give pari passu charge. It depends on case to case and the way in which we attack the issue. When the banker is convinced, yes, he is going to get bailed out of NPA, number one. Number two, the enterprise is getting into a healthy functioning with assured handholding by us. After all, his burden is completely lost. We are unburdening the banker. We take over the responsibility of monitoring the cash flows, because we make sure whatever cash flows are projected for turnaround are maintained at least for 1 year. And during this process of 1 year, we definitely completely make sure that he is on complete compliance of the regulations. That means we have rebuilt the trust between the banker, primary banker, and the borrower. What we are doing is building a trust between the banker and the borrower that is lost, which is responsible for becoming NPA. And no institution in the country or in the world today has a parallel to TIHCL. We are the only institution doing this job. And without this extra institutional effort, this cannot happen. Because banks have no time today. He is bogged down with lot of responsibilities, which are not material to him, but still he is bogged down. He is more burdened with this third party product sales on which he has measured for his performance. Otherwise, he will not become an AGM. If he does not sell the insurance or some other mutual fund product. I'm not blaming him. His system has, got into that, vicious wheel. And that being the position, there must be an institution which can take care of the multitudinous enterprises. And that is why we had set up this institution. And I'm happy that we have been able to prove ourselves that the concept that we have created really worked well. Next one. This is where we handhold. I have already explained to you how we go. And we insist on every enterprise, whether it is 5 lakhs or 50 lakhs or 5 crores, he should have ERP solution installed with him. Today, Joho is coming free and Government of India is giving free ERP solution. And we can help the enterprise to set up this whole ERP solution through our executives. And beyond 1.5 crore turnover, since he is not entitled for a free ERP solution, he can take the partnered ERP solution, where we have our own partner Syscom Solutions, who will set up the ERP solution on cloud with all that the enterprise should have is email connectivity. And on cloud, he will be uploaded the ERP solution, which will be done by our staff with the help of Syscom Solutions. So that is a paid ERP solution with 1,500 rupees per month. And that way, micro and small enterprises are put on regular monitoring, because we view the consent-based architecture ERP from our own system. We would know whether he is conforming to the cash flows that he has promised, conforming to the turnover he has promised, conforming to the debtor statements he has promised, creditor statements. All things we can see online, and we will be able to decide. If there is an aberration, then our executive will immediately jump into action. And this is the way in which we have been monitoring, and this has paid rich dividends to us. Therefore, I would urge upon the enterprises to take full advantage of this. And for all those who are non-entrepreneurs, but who are academics and consultants, to take forward this concept to the needy entrepreneurs and link them to us. They are welcome anytime. We have a regular office in Parishram Bhavan. They can reach us, or they can reach us even by telephone. They can reach us through our own website. So thank you very much for this opportunity. I will respond to the questions raised by Mr. Deshai during the panel discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Iram Raju. TIHCL is a great support, especially for struggling MSMEs. It was really a great learning for all of us. Your insights given will certainly help MSMEs.